thrill, excitement, curiosity. The Dwarf Planet Ceres. Tucked into the asteroid belt between Mars and Jupiter, the Dwarf Planet Ceres is a small world that holds big surprises. A slew of new research from NASA's Dawn spacecraft advances the case that, in its own cold, salty way, Ceres is a geologically active body with ice volcanoes and surviving pockets of an ancient ocean. It was the first asteroid discovered on January 1, 1801 by Giuseppe Piazzi at Palermo Astronomical Observatory in Sicily and announced as a new planet. Ceres is the only dwarf planet that located in the inner solar system. The rest lie at the outer edges in the Kuiper Belt. While it is the smallest of the known dwarf planets, it is the largest object in the asteroid belt, and when NASA's Dawn arrived in 2015, Ceres became the first dwarf planet to receive a visit from a spacecraft. Well, the idea that liquid water could persist on Ceres, a world that is less than a third of the moon's width, would have once seems outlandish. But now that humankind has seen it up close, we know that frigid tiny Ceres is geologically alive. It is named for the Roman goddess of corn and harvest. The word cereal comes from the same name. Ceres is one of the few places in our solar system where scientists would like to search for possible signs of life. It has something a lot of other planets don't. Water. Here on Earth, water is essential for life. So it's possible that with this ingredient and a few other conditions met, life possibly could exist there. If anything does live on Ceres, it is likely to be very small microbes similar to bacteria. If Ceres does not have living things today, there may be signs it harbored life in the past. Beyond exotic volcanoes, the new findings add Ceres to the growing list of worlds that had all the required ingredients for life at one point or another: liquid water, energy, and carbon-bearing organic molecules. Thanks to the heat of asteroid impact, scientists say that Ceres may have been habitable, though not necessarily inhabited for short periods of time. With a radius of 296 miles for 76 kilometers, Ceres is one-third the radius of Earth. From an average distance of 257 million miles, 413 million kilometers, Ceres is 2.8 astronomical units away from the Sun. One astronomical unit is the distance from the Sun to the Earth. Ceres takes 1,682 Earth days, or 4.6 Earth years, to make one trip around the Sun. As Ceres orbits the Sun, it completes one rotation every 9 hours, making its day length one of the shortest in the solar system. On March 6, 2015, NASA's Dawn spacecraft became the first probe to orbit two bodies in the solar system. After leaving the asteroid Vesta, Dawn traveled to Ceres, an icy world that has tantalized scientists for years. While most asteroids are made of rock, Ceres revealed hint that it could contain water on its surface since 1991, though those hints remained unconfirmed for more than 20 years. As Dawn drew closer to the giant asteroid, a bright spot on its surface grew clearer. After observing Ceres, 130 similar spots of varying brightness were found on the planet. Some of the salty bright spots were laid down within the past 4 million years, so the impact could not have created them. Instead, the fluid must have been coming from an ancient deep reservoir of liquid brine. The brightest region lies in the 56-mile-wide, 90-kilometers Ocater crater, which contains the most famous collection of shiny spots on the surface of Ceres. Ever since Dawn detected Okator's bright spots in 2015, scientists have puzzled over how they formed. Researchers quickly learned the features were made of salts, likely deposited in the crater from brines seeping up onto Ceres' surface. The latest research suggests, however, as recently as 1.2 million years ago, cold underground brine oozed out onto Okator's floor to form these salty deposits. Bulging mountains and hills also support the idea that Ceres experiences a kind of ice-cold cryovolcanism, with briny mud or slush acting like molten lava does on Earth. In one region of Okator's crater floor, Dawn spotted hints that brines had rippled out of ice volcanoes within the past few decades, if not more recently. Whatever slammed into Ceres and created Okator crater likely kick-started the icy volcanism that brought briny material to the surface. Unlike volcanoes on Earth, cryovolcanoes on Ceres develop as ice in the dwarf planet's crust freezes and expands, compressing and pressurizing pockets of underground brines. The Okator impact cracked Ceres' crust, leaving fractures that deep brine could use to wend their way up to the surface. Once this spilled out, the water evaporated, leaving the bright, salty deposits that we see today. If you were to drill, you might be able to reach an aquifer, and then you would get very cold brine to come out. These brine pockets are the relics of a larger, possibly global ocean that once existed on Ceres, as anyone who's driven on a salted road in a winter has seen. Dissolved salts can keep water in a liquid state at temperatures colder than its usual freezing point. In the case of Ceres, the brines are estimated to be about minus 22 Fahrenheit, requiring a lot of salt and possibly a mixture of muddy, fine-grained minerals to stay in liquid form. Dawn and NASA's New Horizons spacecraft, which flew by Pluto in 2015, have shown that small icy bodies are far more active than once thought, stretching how scientists imagine the geology of dozens of alien worlds. Well, I wish astronauts could explore this beautiful yet geologically active world by landing there. But unfortunately, there is no such plan in consideration in near future. A proposal is submitted to NASA for a Ceres sample return mission, which would launch no earlier than 2031. Since it can take years to approve, design, and build a spacecraft, the mission would collect 100 grams of material from Okator's floor and send it back to Earth. Please like, subscribe, and share to support and watch more interesting documentaries on space and planets.